गुड मॉर्निंग माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स. सो मायसेल्फ कीर्ति राय. यस्टरडे वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द डाइवर्सिटी इन द लिविंग ऑर्गेनिजम्स एंड वी हैव डिस्कस्ड सम ऑफ द इंट्रोडक्शन पार्ट ऑफ दिस चैप्टर एंड द ब्रांचेस ऑफ जूलॉजी. वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ लिविंग ऑर्गेनिजम्स एंड वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट इन डिटेल अबाउट दोज कैरेक्टरिस्टिक फीचर्स एंड वी हैव ऑल्सो डिस्कस्ड अबाउट the branches of zoology, right? The different branches of zoology. And now, today, we are going to discuss about the next part of this chapter, that is, okay, now here onwards, we are going to discuss about the levels and hierarchy of classification. First, before understanding that, let's understand what is classification. So classification is nothing but it is the classification is the differentiation or categorizing the organisms into different things based on the characteristic features they have. That is, based on the identical features, we have classified the organisms into different hierarchy or into different categories. And that categories has been given different hierarchy. Now, why we need classification? Classification is needed to understand the animals or to understand the living organisms in a better way, so that we can understand them in and we can learn about them in a better way, and we can utilize the knowledge about them in the human welfare. So that's why we need classification. Like we have classified the earlier, what we have seen, we have classified the organisms based on the type of cell, right? That is eukaryotic and prokaryotic. Then later on, it was classified based on the whether the unicellular or multicellular, or whether they are autotrophic or heterotrophic, whether they are seen by naked eye or by they are seen by the microscope. So that's all about the we have discussed. And that's how the classification is needed, and it was meant for that, so that it can give us easy understanding of the organisms. So here, the classification has been, we have levels and hierarchy of classification. So how animals are classified? Now, if you have learned about in the earlier classes, that is in the ninth class or in some previous classes, they have classified, the main thing is they have classified into these levels of organization. Okay. Now, the first one is domains. So, domains, there are two types of domains. There are three types of domains. And here in the domains, it is based on molecular systematics, that is molecular structure of the living organism. That is, they are going at the DNA level, and this is the latest one. Till earlier, it was only from kingdom and the rest of it, but now one more classification has been added, one more hierarchy has been added, that is domain, and it is based on the molecular organization of the organisms. So this domains of classification has been classified. It is of three types: eubacteria, the organism based on this domains, the domains has been classified into three: eubacteria, archaebacteria, and then the last one is the eukaryotic organisms. So here the eubacteria and archaebacteria, they belong to the Monera only. Monera are what? Monera belongs to the phylum. Sorry, Monerans are nothing but they belong to the kingdom. And kingdom Monera, it is the all the prokaryotic organisms. They are grouped into a single kingdom, that was kingdom Monera. Now, what they have done, the domains, when the domain came into picture, this kingdom Monera has been classified into two. That is, it has been classified into two domains. Just one kingdom has been classified into two domains, and that was Archaebacteria and Eubacteria, and the last one, the kingdom, the eukaryotes are the third domain. We will discuss about that in detail. So after the domains, the next one is kingdom. Okay, so a group of kingdoms will be forming the domain, and then phylum. So a group of phylum will be forming kingdoms, then class, then order, family, genera, and species. So this is the hierarchy of classification. This is how the animals are classified. Means there are some, or there all the organisms will be kept in three domains, and that three domain has been classified into kingdoms, and the kingdoms are differentiated into phylums. Phylums are differentiated into class. Classes are differentiated into orders. Orders into family, and then genus and species. So this is the lowest level. That is, species is the lowest level of classification. The scientist Linnaeus established a definite hierarchy of taxonomic categories called taxa. Now at each level, this each level is known as one, we call it as taxa, and together it is known as taxon. Okay, so it was this hierarchy of classification, this definite hierarchy of classification was first established by the scientist Linnaeus. You have to remember that. Then Haeckel, the another scientist, he introduced the taxon phylum. So phylum taxon was introduced by Haeckel, whereas the whole hierarchy of classification, that is, the organism should be divided into different, the classification should be divided into different hierarchy, was proposed by or established by the Linnaeus. And the last one, as I told you, domains are the latest one. And this is the latest hierarchy which has been added into the classification. And this domains of classification was introduced by the scientist Karl Voss. Karl Voss and his associates, they have introduced, and it is based on molecular systematics. So molecular systematics means based on the, we can say, molecular level of the DNA or molecular level of the structures which are present in the cell. So this is the most latest one, and it is based on the advanced technology. So that's why the domains of classification is the latest one, and it is proposed by the scientist Karl Voss and his co-workers. So this is about the hierarchy of classification. Next we will see, based on that hierarchy, we will see where the human stands. What is the hierarchy of humans? So when you see humans, as I told you, there are three domains of classification. One is eubacteria, another one is archaebacteria. Archaebacteria are the primitive bacteria, and eubacteria are the, we can say, they are the advanced bacteria when compared to the archaebacteria. And at present, mostly we find archaebacteria, eubacteria only. And this, you see, this is the classification of human. So human belongs to the eukaryota. Eukaryota means what? They have a well-defined nuclear membrane around the nucleus. Then kingdom Animalia. So kingdom Animalia, they are the group of organisms which cannot prepare their own food, right? They cannot prepare their own food. They show heterotrophic nutrition. So human, Homo sapiens, they belong to domain Eukarya, kingdom Animalia, phylum Chordata. Why we are considering them as phylum Chordata? Because notochord is present at any one stage of life. So notochord is not present in the adult, but notochord is seen in the embryonic stage. That's why human beings are classified into phylum Chordata. Otherwise, notochord has been replaced by vertebral column in the humans, that is in the adult stage. I mean, when they are born. And then they belong to the class Mammalia because they have mammary glands. Order primates, family Hominidae, genus Homo, and species is Sapiens. So this is the classification of humans. So when you have to write the classification of humans, you have to write about all these things. Okay? Or in exam, they may ask you, the human or Homo sapiens belongs to which order? So the answer will be, they belong to the order primates. Or they belong to which family? They belong to the family Hominidae. hominidae. So these two are mostly important. Rest all, it is very well known to everyone. The order and family is the one we have to remember. The taxonomy. What is taxonomy? Taxonomy deals primarily with the description, identification, nomenclature and classification of organisms. So that is taxonomy. We have also already discussed the branch of zoology. One of the branch of zoology is taxonomy, which deals with this description, identification. Description means describing about the organism. Then identification, identifying the organism based on the particular characteristic features. Nomenclature, giving them name and classifying them into a different category. Now, five kingdom classification. The five kingdom classification, this was proposed by Robert H. Whittaker. Scientist Whittaker, we use the term R.H. Whittaker in the year 1969. He has proposed the five kingdom classification. Now, he has classified the first organisms based on the type of nucleus. So based on the type of nucleus, or we can say the based on the cellular structures, they are classified into prokaryotic and eukaryotic. Prokaryotic organisms are nucleus without nuclear membrane. So there is no well-defined nucleus. Eukaryotic, well-defined nucleus is present, and other membrane-bound cell organelles are also present. And there are other differences such as 70S ribosome, 80S type of ribosomes, and other membrane-bound organelles are present in the eukaryotes, and membrane-bound organelles are absent in the prokaryotes. So those are the differences between prokaryotes and eukaryotes. So the first defining feature was presence of a well-defined nuclear membrane. Presence or absence means in prokaryotic, well-defined nuclear membrane is absent. And in the eukaryotic, well-defined nuclear membrane is present. So that is the first classification. Okay, that is the first feature to classify the organisms, all the living organisms into two. Now, when we see prokaryotic, it comes into the kingdom Monera. So this is the first kingdom as per the classification of R.H. Whittaker, where he has given five kingdom classification. This five kingdom classification, first kingdom is Monera. And what are they? They are prokaryotic organisms, means they don't have a well-defined nuclear membrane. And what are the organisms which comes under the Monera? All the bacteria will come under the kingdom Monera. It can be eubacteria, it can be archaebacteria, means it can be primitive bacteria or it can be advanced bacteria. All the bacteria which are present in the nature or which has already been extinct, all the bacteria will come under the kingdom Monera. The second kingdom. Now this eukaryotic organism has been classified into two types. Now based on what? Based on number of cells. So based on number of cells, the eukaryotic organisms are classified into two types. So if they are single cell, then they are considered as unicellular. If they are many cell, more than one cell or more than two cell like that, multicellular, they are considered as multicellular. So that is the second level of organization. That is, based on the number of cells, the eukaryotes are classified into unicellular and multicellular. But all of them have eukaryotic cell only. Means they have well-defined nucleus, they have membrane-bound cell organelles, they have ATS type of ribosomes. All those are the common characteristic features. Now, this based on number of cell, if it is unicellular, means if there is just a single cell, then the organism is a, then that organism will be a, it belongs to kingdom Protista. Okay, so all the unicellular organisms, there are some exceptions, all the unicellular organisms are included in the kingdom Protista. And this kingdom Protista only has been divided into phylum protozoa. We know about the phylum protozoa. There are so many organisms, all the unicellular organisms. You can talk about amoeba, you can talk about paramecium, you can talk about entamoeba, which causes amoebiasis, which is a parasite, then plasmodium. Okay, all these organisms, they are placed in the kingdom Protista. And this kingdom Protista has been divided into phylum Protozoa. Okay, the next one. Now multicellular. Based on multicellular, now based on multicellular organisms, now those organisms which have more than two cells, now these multicellular organisms, again, they are classified into two types based on the presence or absence of cell wall, whether the cell wall is present or absent. Now, what is cell wall? If you see a cell, around this cell, there is another structure, right? In some of the organism, around the cell, that is, generally, a cell will be bounded by cell membrane. This is the cell membrane, right? So now this around this cell membrane, there will be another structure. There will be another thick wall structure, which is known as cell wall. So if cell wall is present, then the organisms are classified into different types. And if it is absent, they are classified into different types. So with cell wall, the ones who are having cell wall are classified into two types. Okay. They are plantae and fungi. Okay, now why they are classified into two types? They can be in one only, right? But it's not the case. They are this the organisms with cell wall are classified into two types because they both have a different type of nutrition, different mode of nutrition. One is phototrophic, other one is heterotrophic. So phototrophic means, you know what is phototrophic? It means that they can prepare their own food. By capturing sunlight, they can prepare their own food. So those organisms which can prepare their own food are classified into kingdom Plantae. So this will be your third kingdom. First kingdom was Monera. Second kingdom was Protista. Third kingdom is Plantae, or we can consider third kingdom as fungi because this is the more primitive when compared to the plants. And then the fourth one will become the Plantae. So in fungi is heterotrophic. They cannot prepare their own food. Whereas plants are autotrophic. They can prepare their own food. But they both have the cell wall. Okay. They both have cell wall. But the difference is they have the type differences in the mode of nutrition. One is phototrophic, other one is heterotrophic. So this is based on presence of cell wall. Third one is the last one is without cell wall. So those organisms which don't have cell wall around the cell membrane, that is just there is a single membrane which covers the cell, and that is cell membrane. Only cell membrane is present. So all those organisms are placed in the kingdom Animalia. Okay, so this is how the classification is done. And it was proposed by, this is the five kingdom classification came. First kingdom is Monera, second kingdom is Protista, third kingdom is Fungi, fourth kingdom is Plantae, and the fifth kingdom is Animalia. And it was proposed by Robert H. Whittaker in the year 1969. This is very much earlier. Okay. And at that time only we knew about all these organisms, and the classification is known as five kingdom classification. This is the most accepted classification. Now, as I told you, the domain classification, it came later on because it is based on molecular systematics. Now, molecular systematics means studying the structures of organism at the molecular level, which can be possible only if we have microscope or only if we have advanced technology in which we can see them. We can see and we can study about the molecules, that is when the cell biology has come into existence. So all those things we need to understand the molecular level of organisms. So the this is the most latest one, and it is this three domain of classification. It is classified into three domains. That is the bacteria, archaebacteria, and eukaryota. So the we can say first one, bacteria. First domain is bacteria. Second domain is archaea or archaebacteria, and third domain is eukaryota. So the all the Monera, what we have learned, Kingdom Monera, right? Kingdom Monera means it includes all the eubacteria and archaebacteria. All the prokaryotic organisms are included in the Kingdom Monera, right? So these two, we can consider the two domains will be forming one kingdom. That kingdom has been divided into two domains, bacteria and archaea, but they all are prokaryotes. But they, based on their molecular structure, based on their structure at the molecular level, they are classified. It was studied that they both don't have similar characteristic features at the molecular level. So that's why they have classified them into bacteria and archaea. Then the eukaryota is same. Eukaryota, what we have learned in the eukaryota, it includes all those four kingdoms, that is animals, fungi, plantae. And all these are nothing but we can consider them as protista. All these are unicellular organisms, and they are considered as one kingdom, that is protistum. Ciliates means the ones who have cilia, right? Like for example, paramecium. Then flagellates, like those organisms who have flagella, like Euglena, Trichomonas, Microsporidia, Diplomonas. All these things are that protozoa or protista is only classified based on the type of locomotory organelles they have. Okay, and here if you see, the bacteria is classified into different types based on whether they are gram positive or they are gram negative, based on the type, based on the method of nutrition they get. So based on that, they have been classified into different types. So this is about three domains of classification, and it was proposed by whom? Earlier we have seen it was proposed by Carl Woese, scientist Carl Woese et al. Means along with Carl Woese, there were other people also who were involved in three domains classification. The next thing is nomenclature. What is nomenclature? Okay, before going to that, mostly the organisms are called by their local names, right? We know that most in our case, if we have so many languages in the world, and there are so many places in the world, and everywhere, most of the places, they have their own language. So if you see, mostly the organisms are called by their local names, which vary from place to place and even within the same country. In India also, suppose if you see mango, there are so many names to the mango, right? So there is a need to standardize the naming pattern of living organisms. So nomenclature is nothing but naming the organism, giving them a single name, which will be common throughout the world to avoid the confusion. The process of naming of animals, not only animals, all the living organisms with distinctive names is called nomenclature. Naming of organism is done as per ICZN. And now here, we are discussing the zoology only. So the naming of all the animals is done by ICZN. What is ICZN? ICZN is a international code of geological nomenclature. So this is the organization who will be naming the organism. So if you want to name an organism, you have to approach the ICZN, and they will be giving a particular name to a particular organisms. Now, as you see in the world, the number of species known and described ranges between 1.7 to 1.8 million. And if you see, to each species, there is so many names. So it becomes very difficult to identify and very difficult to study about them. That's why the nomenclature was introduced. The binomial nomenclature. Carlos Linnaeus, scientist, we have already learned, right? The one who has popularized the taxonomy. So Carlos Linnaeus popularized the binomial nomenclature. So he is the scientist behind all these nomenclature, taxonomy, we can say. So he popularized the binomial nomenclature by using his book Systema Naturae. You have to remember the names of the books, very important. So the book which was proposed by Carlos Linnaeus was Systema Naturae. In this, organisms are provided with two names, genus and species. So we have not in the hierarchy of classification, the last two hierarchy was species, last one was species, and before that was genus. So a group of species will be, a group of species are considered into one genus. So according to him, he gave two names to a particular organism. One name was genus, second name was species. And name must be Latin. It should be Latinized because this is the earliest, or we can say the earliest language. So at that time, most of the scientists were from that region only. And it should be printed in italics. So it should, the name should be Latinized. And when written, it, if it is printed, it should be printed in italics. The first word refers to the genus, and the second word refers to the first word refers to the genus, and it should be noun, and it should begin with a capital letter. Here you see Homo sapien. If you see the first word of the human is the name, scientific name of human being is Homo sapien. The first word is genus. So genus, if you see it, it should be noun, and it should, the first word, first letter should be written with capital letter. Okay, the second word is specific epithet. It is mostly an adjective, and it is written with small letter. You can see here it is written with small letter, and it should be an adjective. When written, the two words should be underlined. So when it is written, it should be underlined. If it is not written in italics, if it is not printed, because we can print in italics, and when it is written, the two letters should be underlined separately. The species should be underlined separately, and genus should be underlined separately. Scientific name of lion. The scientific name of lion is Felis leo, and it has to be, the Felis is the genus name, and leo is the species name. The Felis, the first letter is genus, and it should be noun, and it is written with capital letter. The leo is the species name, and is written with the small letter, and both the letters are separately underlined. So that is binomial nomenclature. Two name, binomial means two name, and nomenclature is system of naming. Next is kingdom Animalia. So we have learnt about the domain. We have learnt about the three domains, right? The eukarya, bacteria, and eukaryota, eubacteria, and archibacteria. And then we have learnt about the kingdoms, isn't it? There were five kingdoms: kingdom Monera, kingdom Protista, kingdom Fungi, kingdom Plantae, and kingdom Animalia. So here in this, we will be discussing mostly about the kingdom Animalia, because we are studying about the zoology. So what are the basic characteristic features of kingdom Animalia? When we were learning the classification, what we have learned? All the organisms which belong to kingdom Animalia will be eukaryotic, isn't it? Because it belongs to the domain eukaryota, they are multicellular, means they have many cells in their body. Heterotrophic, they depend on other organisms for their food. They cannot prepare their own food. The next is, they are capable of controlled locomotion. Locomotion means what? They can move from one place to another place. So the kingdom Animalia, most of the organisms except one or two, they are capable of controlled locomotion. They can locomote from one place to another place, and they can stop whenever it is needed. So that is another characteristic feature. And they have unique nervous and muscular tissues, which will be able them which will help them, nervous tissue will help them to coordinate, because they are multicellular, they need coordination between the cells. For that, nervous tissue will play an important role, and muscular, because they need movement from one place to another place, as well as for their different activities also, they need movement. So the muscular system will come into picture. Heterotrophic nutrition. They depend on other organisms for their food, and they reproduce sexually. Most of the animals, most of the organisms which belong to kingdom Animalia, they reproduce by sexual reproduction. So these are the basic characteristic features of kingdom Animalia. I hope it is clear. See, kingdom Animalia, it has been classed. This is the classification of kingdom Animalia. The kingdom Animalia, which is a multicellular organism, and it is classified into two based on the level of organization. If it is a cellular level of organization or tissue level of organization. So cellular level of organization means the cells are present. There is no coordination between the cells. So there are so many cells, but they do not form into a tissue. Now, this cellular level of organization, there is one phylum, that is phylum Porifera. When you see tissue level of organization, again, it is classified into two types based on the type of symmetry. Based on the type of symmetry, it is classified into two types, whether it is radial symmetry or bilateral symmetry. Okay, if it is radial symmetry, the organ means the organism can be divided into two parts passing through any plane. Okay, that is the radial symmetry. So this radial symmetry example for radial symmetry is, there are two phylums, Coelenterata and, or also known as Cnidaria, and Ctenophora. Okay, then the bilateral symmetry, the organism body can be divided into two equal or passing from the center only, that is passing from the principal axis only. So without, now this bilateral symmetry, organisms with bilateral symmetry are again classified into three types based on the type of coelom they have. Whether their coelom is absent, that is acoelomates. If coelom is present but it is a false coelom, then it is pseudocoelomates. And if coelom is present and it is a true coelom, then it is a coelomates. Okay. Now, acoelomates who don't have body cavity, organisms without any body cavity are considered as coelomates. Coelom means body cavity. A means absence of body cavity. So, organisms which don't have body cavity are platyhelminthes. Those with false coelom are aschelminthes. And with true coelom, it starts with the phylum Annelida and till the Chordata, that is the last phylum. This is the classification. In detail, we are going to study about this classification in the second chapter. The other one is trinomial nomenclature. It is the extension of the binomial nomenclature. In the binomial nomenclature, there were only two names, right? Genus and species. Here in the trinomial nomenclature, another name is added. It permits designation of subspecies. So apart from species, the next hierarchy is subspecies, with a three-word term called trinomen. Subspecies is a category below the species. Example, Homo sapiens sapiens. This is the scientific name of man, where the third one refers to the subspecies. First one is genus, second one is species, third one is subspecies. Like this, we have another name, that is Corvus splendens, which is the scientific name of crow. The next one is tautonym or tautonomy. Practice of naming animals in which the generic name, that is genus, and species name are same, that is known as tautonomy. Example, axis, that is spotted deer. Here you can see both genus and species name, they are same, but they are written separately and they are written with their following their binomial nomenclature. That is, genus should be capital, species should be small letter. The other one is Naja, the Indian cobra. Okay. Now we will discuss some of the questions related to this topics which we have discussed just now, and the rest of the we'll resume the chapter tomorrow. So let's discuss some of the neat questions. So the first question is, compared to genus, which of the following is less general in characters? Means which one will come below the genus? Is it family? Is it species, division, or class? So the answer is species. So as we have learned, the after the genus, which one is the higher in the hierarchy of classification? After the genus, which one will come? Which taxa will come? It is the species. So the correct answer is B. The correct sequence of taxonomic categories is species, genus, order, phylum, species, order, genus, kingdom, genus, species, order, kingdom, or none of these. So which one will be the correct? The correct one is, what is the correct hierarchy of classification? It is the species, as we have seen, the first kingdom, then phylum, then class, then order, then family, then genus, then species. This is the order. So when we go from down, so species give rise to, means a group of species will be forming genus, then family, then order, like that. So here, as family is not given, so we can go for species, and then genus, then order, and then phylum. So the correct answer will be A. Taxonomy hierarchy refers to classification of species based on the fossil record. A list of botanists or zoologists who have worked on the taxonomy of a species or a group. A group of senior taxonomists who decide the nomenclature of animals and plants, or stepwise arrangement of all categories for classification of animals and plants. So what is the taxonomic hierarchy? The taxonomic hierarchy is it is the stepwise arrangement. We have seen earlier all as well. It is the stepwise arrangement of all the categories. What are the categories? Categories are nothing but the domain. Each taxon will be considered as one single category. That is domain, then kingdom, then phylum, then order, class, order, family, genus, species. Which one of these categories has a real existence? Species, genus, kingdom, phylum. Means which one exists really? We can say that this is the species. Genus, they are just imaginary things, like kingdom, phylum, all these are imaginary. They are just meant to make the to classify the organism. But when we see species is the one that is at the species level, we can see the organism. So this, the real existence is the species. Species really exist. A true species comprises of a population. That is when they show interbreeding, sharing the same niche, reproductive isolated, feeding over the same food. So when we can say a true species, when we can say that an organism is a true species, when they are reproductively isolated, means if they reproduce within themselves, if they reproduce within the same population. What is population? Population is a group of organisms which are reproductively isolated, right? They belong to a same species, a group of organisms which belong to the same species. Why we are calling them as reproductively isolated? Because if the two organisms are interbreeding with each other, they have to produce a fertile offspring. If they are producing a fertile offspring, then only they can be considered as a single species. And if they are reproducing with the other organisms, then, I mean other species, then they cannot produce a fertile offspring. So then we can't call them as a single species. So it will, the most important characteristic feature is
reproductive isolation. One of the first acts in taxonomy is identification, description, naming, classification. What is the answer? The first characteristic feature in the taxonomy is the identification. First, we have to identify the organism. Then only we can describe about it. Then only we can name it and we can classify. Without identification, we can't proceed further. So one of the first acts in taxonomy is identification of the organism.
Then, what are the things? Okay, this we have discussed already yesterday. Yes, what are the two components of binomial nomenclature? So what are the two components we have learned? The two components are genus and species. So the generic name and specific epithet. So the correct answer will be C. The binomial nomenclature consists of two words, right? The genus name and species name. Genus is written in noun, species is written in adjective. So the generic name and specific epithet. So both A and B are the correct answer. In Mangifera indica Linnaeus, what does Linnaeus stand for? It does it mean Latin Lamarck, Linnaeus, or lower organ? So Linnaeus here, there is one concept is if a particular scientist has proposed any name, has given any name to a organism, that is the one who has given first name. Like Mangifera indica, it was first, Mangifera indica was named, the given scientific name was given by Linnaeus for the first time. So when any scientist who is giving a name to a particular organism who has given it for the first time, their name will be written along with the binomial nomenclature. Their name will be written on the after the species. That is what Linnaeus stands for. So it stands for the Linnaeus. Now later on, this name, if it is by some other scientist, by taking other characters into consideration, if the name has been changed, if the Mangifera or indica, anything, if it has been changed, then also this name of the scientist will be there along with the scientific name, and that indicates that the scientific name for this organism or this plant or this animal was given for the first time by that particular scientist. And they also give the year in the bracket. They also give year along with the name of the organism. So whenever you find this lin or anything which is there along with the scientific name, that indicates the name of the scientist who has first proposed that scientific name. Binomial nomenclature means two names, one given by zoologist, other by botanist. No, one scientific name consisting of a generic name and specific epithet. Two names, one French, another Latinized. Two names, one scientific and other local. So what would be the correct answer? This is a very easy one. It is the one scientific name consisting of a generic name and a specific epithet. The third name in trinomial nomenclature is genus, subspecies, or species. So what is the correct answer? It is the subspecies. So as there are three names in the trinomial nomenclature, first one will be genus, second one will be species, third one will be subspecies. Identify the correct sequence of taxonomic categories. Species. Okay. So with this, the question has been already discussed.
the correct answer is
identify the correct sequence of taxonomic categories, whether it is species, genus, order or phylum. Species, order, kingdom, phylum. This one is the wrong one. Order, genus, phylum, species. This also is a wrong. Family, species, class, genus. This is also a wrong one. So the correct one is species, which is the last one. And then before that is the genus, then order, and then phylum. So the correct answer is B. So with that, we will conclude today's session. And again, tomorrow we will discuss about the leftover topics of this chapter.